Hello, this is Dr. Grande. Today's question asks if I can analyze the mental health and personality factors behind the sovereign citizens movement. Just a reminder, I'm not diagnosing anybody. In this video, only speculating about what could be happening in a situation like this. If you enjoy this video, please like it, subscribe to my channel, and consider supporting me on Patreon. I'll put the link to Patreon in the description for this video. The sovereign citizen movement is an anti-government ideology that started in the United States and spread to a number of other nations like Australia, Britain, Canada, and New Zealand. Sometimes sovereign citizens refer to themselves as freemen on the land. The core of their ideology is that no individual can be governed without first providing explicit consent. So essentially, they don't recognize the authority of the government to tell them what to do. They will not accept restrictions on their freedom. To them, every person is a nation unto themselves. This leads to a number of problem behaviors. Often, they don't pay taxes, they don't get their cars registered, they don't apply for a driver's license, they don't buy automobile insurance, they will not vote, obtain a marriage license, or use zip codes. So I guess they are underrepresented among mail carriers. They don't get along with the police. When the police do approach them, they won't identify themselves, and they often resist. They rarely help in criminal investigations, even if they are not the target of the investigation. It is not known exactly when the sovereign citizens originated. It's believed the movement had its origin in a combination of the Christian patriot ideology and the anti-tax movement. The Christian patriot movement wasn't against government in general. Rather, they were specifically against non-local government. They declared themselves independent citizens, elected their own officials, and established their own common law courts. At some point, we see the sovereign citizen movement takes form and grows substantially. It is estimated there are about 300,000 members in the United States alone, of which about 100,000 are fairly serious in their belief. Unfortunately, members of the group are becoming increasingly violent. Some sovereign citizens have been labeled by the FBI as domestic terrorists. In addition to violence, the group tends to engage in a lot of fraud, including mortgage fraud, bank fraud, and selling false credentials, like passports and documents that claim to grant diplomatic immunity. Now I'll take a detailed look at their beliefs. As I mentioned, the central belief is they don't recognize the government's authority over them. They believe they can renounce their status as conventional citizens and reclaim their sovereign rights. Some believe that they must put this renunciation in writing, whereas others believe they don't owe the government an official declaration. When it is in writing, the verbiage is typically odd and bizarre. So it's really beyond the idea of just having some type of choice as to what type of citizen they will be. Most members also have wider conspiratorial beliefs. They believe that members of the government are actively interfering with the dissemination of knowledge about the right to become a sovereign citizen. Like there's something written in a rule book that says people can do this, and the government officials are putting their hand over it and saying, you don't want to look at that. Furthermore, they believe that the government is actually illegitimate, so its formation in the first place was not the will of the people, and it represents corruption. They believe that they are bound by God's law or common law, which they view as the origin of the governmental system. The sovereign citizens have a very interesting view of birth certificates. At first glance, one would think they would reject the idea of a birth certificate because it's a document that is sanctioned by the government, but that's not how they view them at all. They believe that at some point, perhaps around 1933, after the gold standard was abandoned, the government came up with a new standard, which was to back the US dollar using citizens as collateral. So instead of the gold standard, I guess it's some type of citizen standard. The birth certificate represented a trust account or bond denoting each citizen's monetary value. Each trust account was initially funded with between $600,000 and $20 million. So essentially, they believe that conventional citizens are slaves to the state, with the money in these trust accounts being traded on some type of international bond exchange. A corporate shell account like this is referred to as a straw man, a corporate identity created by the government. they refer to a straw man by using their name in all capitals. So when they use all capitals, that's the straw man. When they use lowercase, they're referring to themselves. Now here's where it gets even stranger. This belief affords them an opportunity. They refer to this as redemption. This is where they can separate from the state and use the money in that account to satisfy financial obligations. For example, the money can be used to pay for credit card debt, mortgage payments, car payments, and rent. It's more than just failing to recognize the authority of the government. They believe the government owes them money. It is not unusual that when a sovereign citizen is involved in a court proceeding, they will try to submit a copy of their birth certificate into evidence. Now moving to the mental health and personality factors. There are several symptoms and characteristics observed in many people identifying themselves as sovereign citizens. It is important to recognize that any particular individual sovereign citizen may not have any of these symptoms. Let's take a look at some of the common symptoms. Paranoia is one we see quite a bit. They believe they are being persecuted by the government. We see stereotyped and bizarre speech, often of a quasi-legal nature. They tend to use what appear to be carefully crafted phrases. They think they're using correct legal terminology. They do this to avoid prosecution and to discharge their financial obligations. It becomes clear right away they actually have a poor understanding of the law. They often refer to their vehicles as conveyances and alter their license plates to contain words like republic and phrases like kingdom of heaven. Their beliefs are typically egocentric. They seem normal to them as opposed to ego-dystonic. That's when somebody is disturbed by their own beliefs. So we see a lack of insight here. They believe they have attained a level of enlightenment that exceeds the people around them, like they have a special ability to see what's really going on. They believe they can escape liability by using lowercase letters. Again, all capitals refer to the straw man. So they use lowercase letters to be exempt from the rules. They tend to believe in a number of other conspiracy theories. For example, they might believe that the moon landing was faked, that alien lizard people have infiltrated Hollywood and the government. They might be anti-vaccination, and they may believe the earth is flat as opposed to spherical. Sovereign citizens tend to use certain words and phrases much more than people in the general population. Here are a few examples. Free man, accepted for value, domicile, traveling in a private capacity. They like the questions, who is the victim, and where is your oath of office? They use the word near with a zip code, or they use brackets around the zip code. We see the phrases common law, de facto government. They use the term employer ID number as opposed to social security number. They use the term special trust deposit. They refer to the government as a corporation, and they like the term chargeback notice. This one is popular when they are trying to get out of paying a bill. So this allows them to use that money in the trust account to pay for, again, financial obligations. Sovereign citizens are also known to engage in what's referred to as paper terrorism, mostly through filing nuisance lawsuits and liens against public officials. As far as mental health disorders, some are thought to have psychosis, including both hallucinations and delusions, although it is believed that the vast majority are not psychotic. So they probably don't have disorders like schizophrenia or a major mood disorder with psychosis. Even though their behavior often appears delusional, they may not qualify as having delusions because their beliefs are sanctioned by a large group. Interestingly, the sovereign citizens do tend to stay together. They communicate frequently about their odd beliefs. Their beliefs represent the transmission of misinformation combined with gullibility and paranoia, more so than a true delusion. We also see that Cluster A personality pathology and symptoms are overrepresented in this group. The Cluster A personality disorders are paranoid, schizoid, and schizotypal. They are thought to be on a continuum with schizophrenia. It is not unusual to see grandiose and narcissistic behavior as well. We see a sense of entitlement, overconfidence, and arrogance. Interestingly, the presence of legal stressors due to their behavior seems to drastically increase their level of conviction in the sovereign citizen values, suggesting that many of them are simply trying to escape the consequences of criminal behavior. With all this in mind, it becomes clear that there is no one profile for members of this group. Some of the members appear to have mental disorders, like those involving psychosis and extreme personality traits, whereas others do not appear to have any mental illness at all. Their beliefs are conspiratorial, but they also happen to have a convenient utility for committing theft and fraud. Therefore, this belief system will be attractive to a wide variety of potential motivations. It's not just members that are susceptible to bizarre thinking, but also there are con artists in the group. The spread of this belief system to so many people points to the dangers of conspiratorial thinking. It's not just that one person believes something that isn't true, it's really about the ability to transmit those beliefs. With this particular movement or conspiracy theory, there is an element of danger. Often conspiracy theories are thought of as bizarre but harmless. Here we see an exception to that rule. Beliefs like these can be maintained without psychosis. They represent subclinical delusional thinking, so a level of delusional thinking that would not normally be treated by a mental health professional. This level of thinking is consistent with insufficient evidence integration, so jumping to a conclusion after seeing certain evidence without considering the rest of the evidence available, essentially a lack of critical thinking skills. I find this movement to be pretty interesting. Most conspiracy theories don't have an upside to the person who believes in them. For example, if someone believes in alien lizard people, they usually don't believe that the lizard humanoids are going to give them money or break them out of jail. It's like the members of this group were thinking, if we're going to make stuff up anyway, we might as well get something out of it. I mean, how convenient is it to find out you're owed up to $20 million? Although, if they're going to make things up anyhow, they should have made it like $1 billion. They could write a book titled Turn Your Conspiracy Theories into Cash, although I don't know how they would reliably ship them places without using zip codes, so their sales might be a little sluggish. In a sense, this movement provides a convenient way to escape any legal responsibility, although not actually a good way to escape it, but in someone's thinking, they could look at this as the ultimate exception to all laws. Rather than fight each law on its merits, it's easier to simply say, I'm exempt from all legal action. Again, highly convenient to a con artist, but also, I think, something that is tempting for somebody with conspiratorial thoughts. Those are my thoughts on the sovereign citizen movement. Please put any opinions and thoughts in the comment section. They always generate an interesting dialogue. As always, I hope you found my analysis of this topic to be interesting. Thanks for watching.